Rama wanting to cross ocean and reach Sri Lanka, and he ordered the sea king Varun to part ways, and Varun suggested that it would tip the balance and it would not be good for the mankind. So he advised him to consult his supply chain consultants, experts Nal and Neel, to construct a bridge. So supply chain problem is not a new problem, it is an age-old problem. And what Nal and Neel did was to collect all the logs and boulders and put them in the ocean. And what he did was to use his magical power to make them float. So in the real world, for us mortals, the magical today is the digital, right? So when digital melts with the physical, you can do many, many things quickly, you can do them better, and you can do something which probably you would not think of doing earlier. What this digital world does is to give the smartness. The smartness is derived from the digital, and that comes through the three I's: the interface, the interconnection, and the intelligence, the three I model. The interconnection in the interface, Mr. Mittal explained all these in great detail. You have devices, the devices get connected to the networks, and all devices are interconnect, and they connect to the application world, and the application is what provides the intelligence in making taking decisions, in doing things that you would not normally expect to do efficiently and reduce the cost. Now, does it solve the problem, the real world's problem? I mean, Mr. Mittal gave in detail how it would be done. Does it solve the real world problems? One example that comes to my mind is the example of a smart city in Barcelona. You can call it a smart city example, or a waste management example, or a supply chain management example, where in every bin, waste bin, the sensors were put. They would detect when the bins were to be picked up, and they will talk to the application, which will direct the nearest truck to pick the bins up, and it saved the city a considerable amount of money, and it became a very good example of what IoT or M2M can do to solve the problem of the people, right? And in the Indian context, can we do that? Another example that comes to my mind is the problem of public distribution system, for example. It is a real supply chain management problem, leading to a lot of leakages, the issues of transparency, the issues of efficiency, and the money involved is humongous in billions of rupees. Now, if you use the IoT or M2M techniques, probably you could manage the warehouses efficiently, their environment, their efficiency. You could use the logistics part intelligently. You could turn the fair price shops, integrate their POS, provide electronic weighing machines, integrate them to the whole system, and provide the users some kind of authentication, which will bring more transparency in the whole system. So in the whole ecosystem, you will bring the transparency, you will bring stop the leakages, and maybe save a huge amount of money for the taxpayers. Now, if you can do that for government, you can also do that for a lot many other applications, and that is what is our challenge: to bring IoT to the people, to turn it into reality, to solve our day-to-day real world problems. And for that, again, we need we have few challenges. Mr. Mittal talked about a few of them, mainly related to standards, challenges related to working in silos, and that is a challenge not only in the government but in the private sector as well. We tend to work in silos and then pay the price at a later date. We also have the challenges of cost, because in the Indian market it is a very cost sensitive market. Unless we can do something cheaply, probably we will not touch it. And in order to reduce that cost, probably we have to invest. So it's a cyclic problem. We don't invest enough. If we don't invest, we probably will not. We need to invest in R&D. We need to invest in putting our systems in place, and we need to invest in skilling. And if we don't do that, we will not be able to reduce the cost, and we will not be able to scale up. Scaling up is our biggest challenge. And besides that, we also need a policy framework. In terms of some of the policies, Mr. Mittal, as he told, the DOT released a M2M roadmap. It's a roadmap. It's not a policy enacted. The roadmap gives a clear indication of what the policy direction would be, but we need to act on the roadmap that was prescribed, and that policy framework should be placed very, very quickly. Besides that, we also, one of the other point that I would like to add, and which is generally not discussed in the conference, is that we need to actually really see what the smartness is. Does it suit our requirements? Does it solve our problems? Or is it just that transportation of technology that we import? And I'm not saying and referring to Make in India, but we need to have an Indian context. And on that note, I would end by just telling you a joke. Two ladies were, discussing about their dogs, how smart their dogs are. So one lady said that my dog every morning, when the newspaper vendor comes, he runs, picks up the newspaper and brings it to me. The other lady said, okay, I know that. So the first lady asked, how come? The other lady says that my dog told me so. Right? So we need to understand the context of smartness, what smartness is and what it can do. And on that note, I would conclude and start a discussion, a smart discussion. Thank you very much. Let me introduce Mr. Taparia. Mr. Ankit Taparia, graduate from Birla Institute of Technology and Science, Pilani, in 2010, and a master's in telecom from Aalto University, Helsinki. He graduated at the top of his class and published two research papers on spectrum economics, IEEE Dynamic Spectrum Access Networks, 2012, and International Telecommunication Society, 2012. While representing Aalto University at Mobile World Congress in 2012, he met a young man who would later go on to become his co-founders at Terra Matrix Technologies India. Ankit also, with his co-founders, conceptualized Terra Matrix with an idea to unify network management within multi-vendor, multi-technology environment at telcos and other CSPs, with their first client being BSNL. Now they are a team of 70 plus with offices in Gurgaon, Mumbai and Jaipur, working with organizations like Tata Communications India, MTS India, Volvo Eicher India, Bhutan Telecom and National Communications Authority, Ghana. Terra Matrix has been recently awarded IoT Innovation Award at 2nd BSNL TEMA National Telecom Summit and Awards 2015. Mr. Ankit Taparia currently works as VP Sales and Marketing at the Terra Matrix Technologies Private Limited.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, sir, for the introduction. So the forum which we are at today, it talks about smart supply chain vision. And before vision, we talk about the real ecosystem, the ecosystem which we have today right now. And so that we can build upon on top of that and maybe, achieve whatever the vision is laid out. So from the ecosystem part, I would like to mention where I'm coming from. So it's basically Telemetrics Technologies. We fit into the software platform part of it, where the idea is to aggregate data from different devices, sensors, actuators, and build actionable intelligence on top of it. So the thing being that, where we are currently in the smart supply chain or maybe supply chain scenario. So going back to Mittal's presentation, where he talked about, supply chain, if we break it down on a very high level, so it's going to be like starting from supplier to manufacturer, all the way to your distributor, retailers, and then consumers. It's our perception is that from the consumer side of it, the supply chain has already been pretty smart. I mean, it has already been sorted out in the past few years. And giving examples, you would have all used Ubers and Olas for the taxis. For the groceries, you would have ordered from Grofers. So, you would have seen, all these companies are nothing but technology companies. And what they're doing is that they're making use of, locations of whatever, their fleet, or based on, the traffic conditions, they can actually guarantee that, how much time they're going to reach you, or something like that. So the consumers are benefiting a lot. And the reason being that at the end of the consumer and whosoever is supplying the technology, mobile device has played a really important role. Basically the applications, the apps. So it's not per se IoT or M2M, but we have moved pretty far in that direction. Today, if we talk about this scenario in getting a taxi or anything, something else, it's really amazing. You can actually have complete framework where you know that how much time is going to take. So now how about from the other side, which is basically from the supplier to manufacturer, manufacturer to your distributor and retailer, that supply chain. Where are we in that particular direction? So what our thought is basically a lot of organizations, they are being very receptive to this particular idea of Internet of Things and machine to machine. The biggest bottleneck what they see today is, as what we have also experienced having spoken to a number of these organizations to deploy some kind of an IoT system is, there's a lot of CapEx involvement. CapEx in the sense that, I need to, if I'm a CEO or CIO of any of the, let's say, oil and gas industry or any retail chain. So they say that there's a lot of CapEx involvement in terms of, sensors to be put or RFID tags or, providing those handheld devices to my people on the field. So there definitely, lies the bottleneck in the mindset of the people. But that is also being subsided because, in everyday scenario, we are using a lot of technology to ease our life. So I'll give you one specific example from the OEM side, where people have started making use of technology, per se IoT, to ease out their problems. So one of the India's largest commercial vehicle manufacturer, so they had a problem regarding, their service vehicles not reaching on time whenever there was a breakdown of their trucks. So the whole idea was that they had an SLA with their customers that, fine, if there's a breakdown, then my truck or my service vehicle should reach within, let's say, some amount of time. But that was not being met. So if you see this particular problem, it's about basically how can we connect the service vehicles with wherever there's a breakdown with some kind of technology in terms of a mapping technology and GPS based technology. How do we combine all these things together to create an end-to-end flow where there's an automation with little bit of human intervention, which in future should be subsided completely. It should not be there because then only the complete or the real IoT case would begin. But anyways, it's a good thing to start off. So what we have done is we have basically combined all their different pieces. Wherever there's a breakdown in terms of a commercial vehicle, there has been a technology provided at that end. The service vans, they have been provided technology where they know exactly where the breakdown happens. And all these things have been connected to their existing call center. So when you combine all these things, so you see there's a intermingling of people, process, data, and things, which helps them to meet the SLAs. So this is just the beginning, and as I'm saying, we can gauge the scenario right now because it's basically the current scenario. and talk about during the later part of this this thing that how can we, you know, completely minimize or completely eliminate the use of human intervention. That's my thought.
Basically, we are here to discuss regarding how this mass supply chain works in India. As it was said by Ankit earlier, how technology we are interfacing with the day-to-day transportation system. And in terms of logistics has a different dynamics when it relates to any product. For example, consumer durable might be having a separate supply chain forum or separate supply chain mechanism through which it generates or it goes on its operations. Whereas when it comes to pharmaceutical supply chain, there are key aspects to be considered. One is, if you are moving a temperature control shipment from point A to point B, whether that shipment can reach in that point B with a specified temperature, that is one of the readiness what we have to have. Secondly is, what technology can be used to ensure that the same is monitored from point A to point B. And third is the technology to ensure during each and every transit time it is under the control. That's where the technology use comes in, basically, maybe in terms of, you can say, data loggers, or you can say GPS system, which monitors the transport of the shipment from point A to point B, as well as computer interface technology, wherein the client sitting in their own office, they can see what is happening with my shipment, what is the temperature inside the shipment, is it maintained, or is something can be done. And in terms of rectification action for the company which is moving the product, they can also form a plan as to if the shipment is not reaching on time, and if there is any rectification action to be taken in terms of change of shipper or anything of that sort, which can be done. So this is one of the important aspects, I think, which plays an important role in supply chain. And yes, moving forward with integration of the technologies which every field has, I think we can make it still a better place. One of the smallest, you can say, which makes India proud. Without a technology, you must have heard of this. There's a tiffin system in Mumbai, Dabbawalas. They have been transporting millions and millions of tiffins picked up from every single individual, 10 million different users, delivering it to the right person at the right time. Till date, they have never gone wrong. Basically, what they have utilized into this system is a process. A process wherein every tiffin has been identified and they know where it has to be delivered, how it has to be delivered. And till date, touch wood, the world is in fact praising them for their logistics capability, wherein they have been able to deliver each and every time the right tiffin to the right persons. So I think that is smartness. And going forward in this panel of discussions, we'll be discussing more on different aspects of supply chain. Thank you very much.
So good morning to all of you. And very right introduction has been made as far as the smart issues are concerned. And mainly, we have been listening about the technological aspects of it. Now, I will be talking more on the managerial side of the supply chain, especially in the context of smart supply chains. So basically, some of my materials are derived from the book that I have co-authored. And we have been working in this area for quite a long time. And as has been mentioned in the introduction, basically, India is really on the radar screen of many countries. And one of those is countries are is basically Germany. They are really all of, the entire world is looking at us in terms of what we are doing, how we are moving, what is the status of our country in the logistics area, and they are doing very in-depth study about us. So let me make you aware that world is watching us very carefully. Delhi, of course. And NCR region is leading logistics research hub in India, and we are also doing quite a bit as far as the research in the logistics is concerned. So a lot of people have been ranked in terms of their contribution in the research in the form of publications, and we are doing our bit from the academic side. Basically, the smart supply chain, the smartness component, is a relatively recent one, and supply chain is an old age story. So one of those was mentioned by our chairman in terms of what happened in Ramayana. If we can manage our supply chain better, we can not only be competitive but also contribute to the growth of our country. And supply chain has evolved tremendously during the recent past. But let me tell you, while we are talking of the smartness, let me start with one of the largest supply chains that we ever see. That's the FCI, Food Corporation of India. Just to tell you that how we are dealing with our important supply chains, where the food is to be moved from one state to the other state and entire India is to be covered. Look at the way the grains are stored and transported. We have already seen very pathetic pictures like these, where a lot of wastages are there, and this is not very uncommon. Now, this is a supply chain that we have to deal with. Of course, we talk of the many smart technologies, but actually this is also a reality, the other side of the story. Now, what are the problems in this? If we really try to start thinking about it, there is basically the problems related to the management part of it. Everybody knows about the supply chain, the warehousing and other things, but right type of management and functional alignments are not there. The visibility is missing about the information related to the supply chain. Coordination is missing. And therefore, we have problems in the supply chain. And if we say that maybe around 30% of the food are wasted in the supply chain from farm to the dining table or the fork, I mean, we are not it's not an exaggeration. So we really need to look at the transportation and warehousing to ensure that our supply chain are aligned. Now, one of the ways that one can do this is to look at the processes and where do we lack, especially the processes related to sourcing, managing the suppliers, order executions, procurement, understanding the strategies, the analytics part of it, the planning, matching the demand and supply, and also the recent things which have come related to the green and the reverse logistics part of it, managing it, the distribution part and asset management and similar things. So some way we have to develop our supply chain to be capable to deal with the processes that we are dealing with. And if we can manage it better, now our supply chain could perform better. Further to this, what normally we have, that we have a very fragmented view on the supply chain. Everybody is trying to optimize their decisions. We can do this, improvise this. This is a typical Stevens model. By integrating the internal processes, that we can do. And further to that, the second phase of integration requires integrating your inbound and outbound sides of the supply chain, and we can have integrated supply chain. Now, here, the smart system really come into play. But when we want to integrate the supply chain, which is very, very necessary, and the smart devices can and information technology can play a bigger role. So basically, from a very reactive and locally information-based supply chain, we have moved towards the little bit integrated, where interdepartmental planning and demand-driven inventory plannings are there, and information sharing is done between some supply chain partners. Now we are generally, most of our supply chains are at the phase two. What we really want is to move towards a smart supply chain where we can have better capability for predictive forecasting techniques, collaborative planning, forecasting and replenishment, that is CPFR, vendor managed inventory, just in time. All those things are on the are better managed, and basically we can understand the demand better through smart smart approaches and technologies also. So if we can do that, then possibly the demand and supply gap could be matched, and we have to use the technology on the technology side, EDI, ERP, smart technologies, and we can manage the business processes. Then what type of supply chain, what are the special characteristics of the smart supply chains? Now I call it I3. It should be instrumented, interconnected, and intelligent. These are three important ingredients that we should have in a smart supply chain. When we say instrumented, what we mean that we use sensors, as Mr. Mittal was mentioning, RFID, smart devices to automate the transactions, especially related to inventory, locations related information, replenishment, transportation, understanding the bottlenecks in this. Then the second is the supply chain need to be interconnected. And by that, what we mean that our flows should be optimized, multi-tier systems should be integrated, and collaborative decisions should be taken. And the third important characteristics of a smart supply chain would be, it should be intelligent. If the intelligence is missing, it's really not smart. So we should have an intelligent network planning and executions, simulation-based models should be there for managing the cost, time, quality, services, and other criteria. And why should we have this smart supply chain really? It can benefit in reducing the response time, which is very, very important. We all have learned in the supply chain that longer is the cycle time or the lead time, more would be the inventory or the money blocked in your supply chain. So we have to also look at the inventory and demand planning. The smart supply chain really focuses on that. Increase the visibility throughout the system. This is a very, very important component. If the visibility is there in the supply chain, then a lot of problems can be solved. I had an experience with the Britannia when it was implementing its an ERP system, just to illustrate, to push this point further. Now at that time, they were also sponsors of the World Cup cricket, Britannia Khao World Cup Jao. They had the logo. At that time, if you recall, there was International Court of Justice, the verdict came, and the verdict was that you cannot use logo of the World Cup because the trademark related issues were there. And please note that the World Cup was just a few weeks away from the day that this judgment came. It's a typical supply chain problem. And at that point of time, a lot of money has been pumped in the advertisement and everything. And the wrapper which they have printed for all the products, like say for example Good Day and others, they cannot use because of the logo was already printed on that. So time was very short and they didn't have enough packaging material for the biscuits. At that point of time, for the first time I realized that they needed a very accurate information related to from where they can pick up the old wrappers. And they kept calling at many places. I know I could understand the panic at that point of time in their factory. But somehow, the ERP system, which was just in the nascent stage at that point of time, it gave some, we digged it out, and we found that an old wrapper were in the scrap category, maybe in the Gwalior plant. And immediately, it was brought to the Delhi, and of course the world didn't realize, but had it not been located at that point of time, I'm sure they must have lost a lot of money, and their competitors have gained enough, because they have pushed the demand because of their advertisement, and they were not in a position to throw the products in the market. Now, this is one simple example. Now, what is the important message in this example is that information visibility all throughout the supply chain is extremely, extremely important. The better it is, the supply chain will be more efficient. So, smart devices, as we have seen in, we have heard previous speakers, will give us the visibility throughout the system. There is possibility of redistribution, rerouting, and resupply the goods, which often happens because of the changing scenarios that takes place in the supply chain. And different stakeholders of the value chain can also be benefited through better planning, accurate information flow, and investing in technologies. The smart supply chain should look like a lean system. Lean, by lean, what we mean, that lesser inventory, green, and also agile. Agile is quick response to change. Now, when we talk of the agility and the leanness and the greenness, again, we have to understand that we should have a total visibility of the system, not only the visibility, but also the speed to react to decisions. And a typical agile supply chain need to have capability of quick response to changes, and for quick response, we need visibility and the velocity at which we can respond to. So basically, the smart supply chain can help us in data visibility, can help, we need to have the analytic capability, Internet of Things type of ecosystem, locations-based supply chain, and the e-enablement of it. The data visibility is basically the core competency of a smart supply chain. It should be innovative, collaborative, help us in comprehensive understanding of the data, and should help us in strategic decisions making. Especially, we should have the collaborations among the supply chain partners through information sharing. Then analytics is the second important component that can help us to perform better in a smart supply chain, where if the data comes, information comes, if we are not in a position to derive meaningful inferences out of it, we cannot take decisions, now it's not of much use. So analytics is the next best important component that one should have. It should enable monitoring end-to-end basis, covers all supply chain functions and processes, which I have just mentioned a few minutes before. Alert problems and expectations by predefining thresholds, alerts, and triggers. Ensure data visibility and transparency. Search as performance dashboard. Identify problems for troubleshooting. And become an analytical decision-making tool. Now, please understand that the technology is really not the end of it. After technology, we get data, and the data need to be supported by a strong business supply chain analytics or business analytic tool, and they can help us in doing these things. And for this innovative strategy and technology should emerge out of it by connected device platform, service cloud platform, and in its specific verticals for IoT platforms. So then the next important thing is the traditional locations-based services is the next important feature of a smart supply chain. So we have a request from the locations, and the services are to be provided. And many locations-based needs and the requirements have to cater to through the in a smart supply chain. Because supply chain, every supply chain is unique, And every day we are facing a new type of decision-making scenario. And in that case, the locations-based services are very, very important. For example, just intelligence and data intelligence and data plus intelligence, and we have to provide locations-based services. Fifth important feature of a smart supply chain would be that it should cater to the, it should be replicated in a virtual form also, where object sensing of the physical objects through the sensor and devices, then the data exchange would be required, information integrations, and then application services for decision making, problem notifications, and information handling would be needed. GPS system, global positioning system, is also another way of locating the movement of the fleet of trucks, and also coordinating with the warehouses or the receiving stations. And it can also support the smart supply chain. Cloud-based applications, again, enables smart supply chain to perform effectively. We have to share the computational resources. Coordinations and synchronizations in the decisions making are possible through the cloud-based services. It provides a very important feature for about this is that cloud is basically use-based expenditure. The more you, it depends upon how much you use the cloud services, and according to the requirement, your investments are involved in this. So basically, the power of this would be that through the cloud-based applications, a level playing field, we can evolve in the supply chain where a small player or the big player, they have their investment goes in proportion to what they use. And it can also help in the collaborative planning, forecasting, and replenishment in a big way, which is basically in a supply chain, what we say, that this is the by this we can reduce a lot of problems like bullwhip effect. We can handle the issues related to inventory and stockout problems. Smart supply chains can help, can lead to the development of smart grids, smart vending solutions, smart buildings, IoT, some wearable solutions like which could be personalized, and transforming any device to IoT where existing standalone products benefit from the IoT platform. There was a survey of the supply chain executives, and from them the information was collected related to the five major challenges for a smarter supply chain. Actually, that's the in the theme of this session. So I have just picked up from that survey the five important major challenges of a smart supply chain. And the most important out of those five is supply chain visibility. Second important one, 60% of the people talked about the risk management to process data, technology, and identified for good risk management. Then the next important one could be increasing customer demand, how a smart supply chain or smart devices can help in increasing the customer demand, and also helping the supply chain objective, like to make goods material available at the right place, at the right time, at the right price. Then the cost containment in terms of fighting integral costs such as might be futile, but being flexible can create cost saving elsewhere. And the last one is the globalization in terms of supply chain. We can manage the lead time, delivery, and quality related challenges in a global context. So maybe I will stop here because I can see the time. We have exceeded 15 minutes. And thank you very much.